Salutations, celestial sightseers. I'm David Fuller. Welcome to Eyes on the Sky. What's up this week? We are moving out of the summer constellation season, but there's one that I really want you to see because I've actually never shown how to find this one before, so shame on me. It's a wonderful nebula, and that would be the Omega Nebula, also known as the Swan Nebula, and the Horseshoe Nebula, and the Checkmark Nebula, and the Lobster Nebula. But most of us know it as Messier 17. Now, Messier 17 is located in a very rich portion of the Milky Way because we're looking right towards the center of our galaxy here in the Sagittarius region of the night sky. So it's littered with objects, both Messier objects and NGC objects, and stars and double stars and that kind of thing. There's even a couple planets over there right now. We've already talked about Saturn and Jupiter. But I want to show you this one because it is a star-forming region that is considered one of the brightest ones in our galaxy, and it is on par with the Orion Nebula, Messier 42. However, this particular nebula is about four times farther away, so it's not as bright to us, but it's still worth looking at because it's one of those major star-forming regions of the Milky Way. So, how do we find that? Well, we can find Saturn over here, and we know where Sagittarius is at, due south, right at about astronomical twilight. I happen to set this up for me in the Chicago area, right about, oh, quarter after or so, quarter after 9 in the evening, which is, it should be fully dark at that point for me. We have no moon because the new moon occurs on August 30th, so even though many of you may see this a few days after, that's okay. We will have functionally not much of a moon interfering for at least several days, so hopefully it's clear for you. What we can do to find this is zoom in and look for the teapot shape of Sagittarius. The handle is near where Saturn's at. Here's my handle. Here's my spout. Here's the steam coming out. What we're going to want to look for is the top of the teapot right here, which is Lambda Sagittarii, also known as Caos Borealis. That is a 2.8 magnitude star, so most everyone should be able to find that without too much difficulty. And then we're going to hop our way over to this star right up there, which is Mu Sagittarii. Now, it's a full magnitude dimmer, it's 3.8. Some of you may not be able to see that naked eye, but you should be able to see that no trouble through a finder scope or binoculars. And we're gonna kind of meander our way up this way through the Milky Way. However, there's a number of things we're not gonna have to help us on our way. I'm gonna show you where the cluster is to start. So if we go to our DSOs like this and click on labels and markers, we can see there we go. We're littered with all kinds of objects. And check it out, it's known as the Omega Nebula, is right here, kind of in between all these other wonderful Messier objects, the small Sagittarius cloud, the Black Swan cluster, the Eagle Nebula, M25. All great objects to look at for sure. However, we're going to focus on this particular nebula. And while it would seem like, oh, well, we just follow that trail of easy things to find up there, it's not quite that simple. So I'm going to help you with the stars that you're going to use to find your way there. If we zoom in just a little bit, I want you to note that star right there, this one near the small Sagittarius cloud, in particular these three. Now remember, here's Mu Sagittarii again, so there's three stars right near there. And then these stars like this and there, right there near the small Sagittarius cloud, again, this one and this one. So sort of a curved X shape. Now let's get rid of all the lines for the constellations because we're not going to have those available to us in the night sky at all. So if we get rid of those, and then we're not going to have any of these other wonderful labels and markers for all those Messier and NGC objects. So we don't really know where we're going for that. Plus, we're also really, most of us are not going to have the Milky Way available to go, oh, well, we just follow the Milky Way. So let's turn that down and see what we actually have. We'll leave that there. And then we are going to limit our magnitude of what we can actually see. Now, this I'm leaving at 6.5, because it was showing some dimmer stars in that, but and most of us won't even see 6.5. But there's more likely what we're going to have available to us probably through binoculars or finder scope. So you can see there's a lot less going on. Now remember those stars I told you about? Here and here and here. These make a nice little meandering line. And then these ones that are going to go across. Those are the ones you're going to see in a finder scope. But we're going to start at Caos Borealis. And we're going to begin with binoculars or a finder scope. And we can put in crosshairs if we want to do the finder scope, but we don't need to necessarily do that. Now, before we get going too far, I do want to point out this little object right here that showed up as a star. But that's actually Messier 28. Definitely look for that. I'm going to punch that in so you can see right there. It's a globular cluster. It's very small, but it's pretty bright. So stop at that one first. Crank up that magnification and definitely take a look at that one. But that's not where we're going. We are sort of going in that general direction, though. So once you get going on that, you're going to see, hey, look, there's another star coming over that way. If I'm sort of going in that direction of Messier 28, and there's Mu Sagittarii. There's those three stars right nearby and another one over here. You can still see Caos Borealis right over there, your 2.8, and there's your 3.8 star. You can get all those in the same field view. So go ahead and center that. Now, look at all those stars in there. That's because we got lots of Milky Way there. Beautiful spot to look at with binoculars for sure. However, probably not going to see all that in our view. So we're going to limit our magnitude down. We're going to bring it way down and look at all the stars suddenly go away. Boop, 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 bye-bye. Let's go to, say, 7.5. Because that's what a lot of us will be able to see is between 7 and 8 magnitude. So we've got Mu Sagittarii here, this one, and this one. Oh, right here. Boom, like that. Now we're going to move up that kind of curved-ish line, remember? So, whoops, I went a little too far. So here's Mu, and here's our curved line going up, and here's our other curved line kind of going this way. Let me see if I can, yeah, we can see all that curving this way, and then these ones curve this way. So you've sort of got these four stars to get you going in the right direction. You go, okay, these are all generally, if I sort of split the line, I can go this direction, like that. And I'm going to be going generally the right way. You're not going to want to use that star because remember, this one is where we cross for kind of our X. We're going to that star right there. And I know that you're seeing all kinds of things along the way. You're going, but Dave, look at this. Yeah, 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 I know. That's NGC 6603 right there. It's a star cluster. However, look at this. The surface brightness is almost 14 and the magnitude is only 11. You're probably not going to see that, especially not in your finder scope. You might see it in a telescope if you've got a large enough one, and if you want to go look for it, definitely do so. If you've got a dark sight, large telescope, definitely take a look at that. It's a great one to see along the way. Perfect object to look at. Then we have this other one right here. We're not there yet because we're actually going right here close to this star. So what is that? Well, that's Messier 18. There it is. Messier 18 is an open star cluster. It's 6.9 magnitude, surface brightness of 11. That's actually pretty bright. It's not terribly big. You can see it's only 7 arc minutes across. So lots of magnification. Again, dark sky sight's going to help, but you can use a lot of magnification on that one to get to pull that one in. That one's not far from our star that kind of makes the X on our the cross of our X set of stars. So that's the closer one. Now we're going to go to this star right there. And in the same field of view, when we bring that up to, say, about a 1 degree or so field, we should have the Omega Nebula. Let's check and see what we've got. So this is not perhaps perfect. It's about a 1.2 degree field of view, so a little bit larger than one. But as you can see, even when we're on that star, I mean, we've got the nebula right there. So it's a fifth magnitude star. Not overly bright, but bright enough for us to be able to find using a finder scope. And then there is the nebula. We can then focus in on that. Our star is still in our field of view. We got a couple double stars right here, probably. V4029 Sagittarii and V4030. But the nebula itself is what we're really wanting to focus on. Now you'll notice that its surface brightness is quite low. It's 13, but check out the magnitude. The magnitude is 6, not 11, like that other one was, the NGC 6603. So this is much brighter, even though it's got a low surface brightness as a nebula. But you're still going to want to employ some of your faint object observing strategies. Dark sky, number one, obviously, if you can. If you can't, then you're going to want to cover your head with a hood, if possible. Block any extraneous light that you possibly can using anything possible. I even have a video on how to set up a tarp for that, if you look back in some of my archives. But put a shield on your telescope, use averted vision if necessary, and I've talked about that a number of times. That's where you focus on the object, but you'll look just slightly away from it. Tap the telescope, because movement is what our eyes really focus on when it is dark. So that movement is what you'll see. You'll see more detail start to pop out using that. And of course, aperture. If you happen to have a larger telescope, you will see more, regardless of where you are. But if the darker it is and the larger your telescope, the more that you'll see. But you can also increase the magnification. Just don't increase it too much, especially if your telescope is small. You might wind up suppressing some of what you might be able to see. But if we zoom in a little, here we've got about a 3/4 degree field of view. That's pretty good framing of the nebula itself. I don't typically see the horseshoe shape too much. You can see how it's here upside down in this view, and this is a reflector. Oh, I'm sorry, this is actually a refractor view, but it is kind of an upside down. So this is like the body of the swan, and then the neck kind of goes up this way, is I believe how it's supposed to go. And then some people see the omega better. I don't see the omega as well. I see the swan a little better, typically. But it's bright enough that you should be able to see this particular cluster. So we're running out of summer. Make sure you take a look at this while you can. The clearer, more transparent your skies, the better you'll see it. I hope you get an opportunity to look at it before it disappears in the autumn. And that's all for this week. Keep your eyes on the sky and your outdoor lights aimed down so we can all see what's up, like more of M17. I'm David Fuller, wishing you clear and dark skies.